I'm TJ Manoto at TFC Studios in the San Francisco Bay Area. Our headlines on BA. More setbacks for President Donald Trump as he focuses on overturning his election loss to President-elect Joe Biden, despite admitting that COVID-19 cases are running wild across America. Most of California under a curfew mandate, and while some took to the streets in protest, business owners are also expressing worry on how they can stay afloat in the next few months. And we talked to some tourists that took the risk to travel to New York for the holidays, despite warnings from health experts to stay home to avoid exposure. These stories and more on BA. Thanks for joining us on BA. The Michigan State Board has voted to certify President-elect Joe Biden's win over President Donald Trump. Another setback for Trump, who continues to focus his attention on overturning his election loss, rather than deal with the country's worsening coronavirus pandemic. Here's more. As the U.S. recorded more than 142,000 new coronavirus cases on Sunday alone, health experts continue to fear for the worst, with Thanksgiving just days away. National and local authorities are not letting up on their appeals for Americans to limit their holiday celebrations to immediate family members living in the same household.
We want everyone to understand that these holiday celebrations can be super spreader events, so we want them to be smart. And we want them to be as small as possible. But again, go to cdc.gov, look at those tips for everyone.
As of Monday, Johns Hopkins University data shows that the U.S. has reported more than 12.3 million COVID-19 cases, with more than 257,000 deaths. Coronavirus cases are on the rise in all 50 states, with North Dakota getting much-needed support now from military nurses. And testing sites in New York getting inundated with people seeking tests ahead of Thanksgiving travel. Despite warnings from health professionals and ongoing COVID-19 outbreaks, the White House plans to hold indoor holiday receptions in the coming weeks. President Donald Trump also took to Twitter over the weekend to blame what he calls fake news for not reporting on COVID-19 running wild all over the world and not just in the U.S. While on the campaign trail, Trump insisted that the U.S. was rounding the turn on coronavirus. Also occupying Trump's time, his continued efforts to overturn his election loss. Trump's legal team has now lost a whopping 34 cases challenging the 2020 polls, and even his closest allies are now asking him to concede to President-elect Joe Biden. Former New Jersey Governor Chris Christie called Trump's legal team a national embarrassment, while Republican Senator Rob Portman of Ohio said there is no evidence as of now of any widespread fraud or irregularities. Meanwhile, the Michigan State Board of Canvassers has voted to certify the state's election results on Monday, formally giving Biden the state's 16 electoral votes. Based on all major U.S. networks, Biden is projected to win 306 electoral votes compared to Trump's 232. Adding to Trump's woes, at least 21 Republican senators have reportedly privately expressed contempt for Trump and his fitness to be president, according to veteran investigative journalist Carl Bernstein.
Angry Californians took to the streets of Huntington Beach over the weekend to protest Governor Gavin Newsom's curfew on social gatherings and other non-essential activities.
USA! 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 USA!
About 100 demonstrators waved the American and Trump 2020 flags in defiance of the curfew imposed on majority of the state's counties beginning this weekend from 10 p.m. to 5 a.m. until December 21. This restriction marks a return to the first in the nation statewide stay-at-home order that was imposed in March, except that it applies only during the designated curfew hours rather than around the clock. According to data from Johns Hopkins University, California has reported more than 1.1 million infections and more than 18,700 COVID-19 deaths. Filipino restaurants in California struggle to stay afloat amid restrictions due to the COVID-19 pandemic. As Steve Angelus tells us, eating spots in Los Angeles County face another hurdle.
Last call for sit-down restaurants in Los Angeles County, at least for now.
We drink every day.
Are you worried if they close down the restaurants, though?
We worried, you know. Latin Filipino, you know, we're not cooking every day. So we have to always buy to go.
Despite not having its signature live music nights and bar at Jerry's Grill in Artesia, the restaurant has managed to stay open with outdoor seating good for 200 people, about half of their pre-pandemic capacity.
Since we were able to install the outdoor tents, our sales have brought us back to a safe level of sales. But it's just, you know, we are not able to do exactly what we want to do. We don't have the music that's not allowed by the county right now. So as far as people coming in, at least we're able to provide a safe environment for them to eat and enjoy the food.
On this Friday night, the evening before LA County was going to limit outdoor dining to half capacity, Manguni was preparing for the scaled-down dining tent, fearing that a full sit-down shutdown was around the corner.
So that's going to affect our weekends, definitely. And hopefully we can get the infections under control and not have to shut down completely. It's a scary proposition for everyone.
His fear did happen a lot sooner than expected, as Los Angeles Public Health announced on Sunday that beginning Wednesday, outdoor dining will be banned for at least 3 weeks.
While this restaurant stays afloat, there's been several other Filipino businesses in Southern California that have been less fortunate.
With the first few months of the pandemic shutting down both indoor and outdoor dining, restaurants had scaled back. Even popular places like Mamsur, Ninong's Cafe, and Barkada made the difficult decisions to close their physical doors for good, while they still continue serving dishes through other means such as catering and pop-ups. Manguni hopes to go orders, delivery, and catering can pick up as the entire restaurant industry tries to stay afloat during this winter surge. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News, Artesia, California.
Up north in San Francisco, community advocates are stepping up to make sure PhilAm residents are getting the help they need to survive the pandemic. Romel Conclara with the support.
When San Francisco's shelter-in-place order was first issued back in March 2020, many Filipino families in the city's Excelsior neighborhood needed food. Most of San Francisco's 40,000 Filipino residents live in that area. And so the Bayanihan Response to COVID-19 collaboration was formed to address food concerns and more. The National Alliance for Filipino Concerns, or NAFCON, worked together with the Filipino Community Center, or FCC, unlike Bayan San Francisco, Philippinex Health Initiative SF, and Mahila Restaurant, in preparing meals for families in need. But there were other concerns from the community.
Community members shared that there weren't enough testing centers available in the 94112 area. And we also highlighted the low levels of Filipino folks and other POC communities who were even getting tested.
These PhilAm advocates said people were frustrated that some testing centers were far or the hours of operations were not enough.
So far there has only been like two testing sites, and all of them have been pop-ups, which means, they're limited.
When it comes to government benefits amid the pandemic, the FCC said many Filipinos were not aware of them other than the stimulus check.
We had to train all of our case managers how to help people apply for EDD UI online. And a big amount of our clientele were people who have never had to be unemployed before. They've been working at their workplace for, years and years.
The FCC said that it was also difficult for Filipinos and other communities of color to understand how to apply for those resources and benefits. So they took on the task themselves.
We've seen that language barriers and cultural barriers affected accessibility to these resources as well as information. So being able to do our food program was really helpful because we were able to disseminate those information.
San Francisco has reported more than 14,500 COVID-19 cases and is on a trajectory to go into the purple tier this week, representing a widespread risk of infection. And we'll have to follow the same curfew order that's been mandated in 41 of California's 58 counties, with a requirement to stay home except for essential trips from 10 p.m. to 5 a.m. every day. From Malcolm Clara, ABS-CBN News, San Francisco.
Despite calls from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, or CDC, to avoid Thanksgiving travel, airport checkpoints already saw its busiest days in months over the weekend. In fact, the number of daily air travelers that passed through airport checkpoints reached the 1 million mark on Friday and Sunday. That's only the second and third time it happened since March 16th, or when the pandemic began in the U.S. Despite this, AAA expects a drop in the number of people traveling by car for Thanksgiving from around 50 million in 2019 to 47.8 million this year. The CDC has expressed concerns the holidays will result in large family gatherings that may cause further spread of the unwanted virus. One White House holiday tradition is here to stay despite the coronavirus pandemic. President Trump is set to make a public appearance Tuesday to pardon a turkey in a White House ceremony. Two turkeys from Iowa have already arrived in Washington. They are named Corn and Cobb, and as tradition dictates, only one of these two lives will be spared. Trump and First Lady Melania will both spend Thanksgiving at the White House instead of attending the annual dinner at his Mar-a-Lago club in Florida. Florida's governor is not succumbing to pressure from mayors to declare a statewide mask mandate or stay-at-home orders, but he's optimistic a vaccine will arrive soon as he plans for its distribution. Paul Garilao reports.
This month has brought promising news regarding therapeutics and vaccines to combat COVID-19. And the state of Florida has been working to procure the new treatment for our hospitals.
Florida Governor Ron DeSantis made this statement in a 5-minute video he recently released. On Sunday, Florida health officials reported close to 6,600 new COVID-19 cases with 62 deaths, bringing the state's total infections to about 940,000 with a total death toll of 18,300 since the start of the pandemic. DeSantis talked about the new therapeutic treatment by Eli Lilly that's been approved for emergency use by the Food and Drug Administration.
We surveyed all hospitals in Florida to determine demand. We sent that information to the federal government, and the Health and Human Services Department used that information and have now sent over 3,000 doses of the treatment directly to hospitals.
DeSantis also said that since July, Florida has been actively planning for vaccine distribution, including purchasing necessary supplies such as millions of syringes, needles, and alcohol swabs. Once approved by the FDA, DeSantis said the Pfizer vaccine will be distributed to 5 Florida hospital systems that have the capacity to store them at negative 70 degree temperatures. Phil and Floridians weighed in on these developments in the fight against COVID-19.
It's not yet proven effective, and I don't want to become a guinea pig.
When fear comes to you, fight that fear with faith that God is there to protect you.
Meanwhile, this PhilAm frontline worker is concerned of the surge in hospitalizations due to COVID-19.
We went from having like no COVID patients, or like from like one or two COVID patients, to having like 6 or 7 just where I work.
Several mayors have called on DeSantis to impose a statewide mask mandate and to be more aggressive in fighting the pandemic.
Governor Ron DeSantis said that he will not impose stay-at-home orders in Florida. In fact, the governor is allowing restaurants, bars, and public gatherings like this to be open at full capacity.
For his part, business owner Darren Mendoza said he makes sure customers and staff at his Filipino restaurants in Miami-Dade and Pembroke Pines are safe.
Every time that they touch the menu, we sanitize it too. And the table, before somebody will take the table that was used.
Experts are predicting Florida to hit 1 million cases of COVID-19 in the week after Thanksgiving. Paul Garilao, ABS-CBN News, Pensacola, Florida.
We go to Canada, where two regions in Ontario undergo a 4-week lockdown to quell the coronavirus surge. As data shows, cases could surge up to 60,000 more by December. The country's top doctor appeals to Canadians to plan safer holidays. More from Rowena Papasin.
Toronto and Peel Region, two of the biggest regions in the province of Ontario, will be on lockdown effective today, November 23 until December 21. This as the province recorded almost 104,000 new cases Sunday. Under the lockdown, gyms, malls, and salons will be closed, and indoor dining in restaurants will not be allowed. Violators will be fined $750. Schools and childcare, groceries, medical and dental offices will remain open. The province has earmarked $600 million in aid for affected businesses.
These measures are being put in place to prioritize the essential services we rely on.
Canada has recorded more than 4,700 new cases Sunday with 62 deaths. Total cases across the country is now more than 330,500. The latest modeling from Public Health Canada shows that cases could surge to up to 60,000 more by December if Canadians continue to increase their contacts.
Tempting for all of us to say, okay, well, maybe I can loosen up a bit more too. But the reality is we need to go in the opposite direction.
Different provinces have already imposed public health restrictions starting last week, including Manitoba, Saskatchewan, and British Columbia, to lessen the burden on hospitals and prevent outbreaks in long-term care homes. Filipino-Canadian care aid worker Gloria Sanchez said their job can get really stressful, and she and her co-workers are always scared that they might get infected with coronavirus.
What if I will bring this to my family? What if I cannot go home because they might be positive?
With the current restrictions in BC, another Filipino-Canadian who works in the food industry has this appeal to fellow Filipinos.
Let's just follow the safety protocols, always wear masks, and always have alcohol in their pocket.
In a tweet, Canada's top doctor Theresa Tam appealed to Canadians to plan safer holidays and look at vaccines as a beacon of hope. Rowena Papasin, ABS-CBN News.
President Trump used his final G20 summit to justify Washington's withdrawal from the Paris Climate Accord. Mr. Trump, without providing evidence, said air in the U.S. was 7% cleaner than when he took office, and renewable energy capacity has increased by over 30%.
The Paris Accord was not designed to save the environment. It was designed to kill the American economy. I refuse to surrender millions of American jobs and send trillions of American dollars to the world's worst polluters and environmental offenders. And that's what would have happened. Since withdrawing from the Paris Accord, the United States has reduced carbon emissions more than any nation anywhere in the world.
President-elect Joe Biden said earlier this month his administration will rejoin the Paris Climate Accord. Speaking of Biden, the president-elect has announced the first of his cabinet appointments. Biden picked Anthony Blinken as U.S. Secretary of State. Blinken served as number two at the State Department and as Deputy National Security Advisor during the Obama administration. Biden also named Linda Thomas-Greenfield as Ambassador to the UN. Thomas-Greenfield served as Assistant Secretary of State for Africa under Barack Obama. Former Secretary of State John Kerry, meanwhile, has been tapped to serve as Special Presidential Envoy on Climate Change. Biden's other nominees include Alejandro Mayorkas, who is poised to be the first Latino Homeland Security Secretary, and Avril Haines, who is set to be the first female Director of National Intelligence. Biden is due to take office on January 20th. He's planning for a scaled-down inauguration due to the pandemic. Many people dream of a New York white Christmas, but amid warnings from health experts not to travel just yet, are people really listening? Don Tagala tells us about the Big Apple's tourism situation and why some people are taking the risk to fly to the Big Apple amidst the pandemic.
Tourism is one of the biggest businesses in New York, bringing in about $72 billion economic activity and $7 billion in tax revenues. But that was before the pandemic. According to data from NYC and Company, last year, there were more than 66 million trips to the Big Apple. In 2020, those individual trips were cut to about 23 million. Pacific Asia Travel Association President Elizabeth Chin said international tourism is the one that's impacted directly.
Tourists aren't coming in. There may be a few, but they're domestic tourism. But actually, domestic tourism has been a bit active at this time. There's a lot of domestic travel and RV travel, which is encouraging in some areas and for people to see the United States for a change.
Houston, Filipina Connie Rodriguez is among the domestic tourists who traveled to New York for the holidays to be with friends.
I'll be celebrating the Thanksgiving with them and also do shopping. With safety precautions, not less yung worry ko about COVID. We have to follow all the rules and protocols.
When it comes to international travel, Philippine Airlines said it's been hit by the pandemic. Its daily JFK Manila JFK flights have been cut to one flight a week.
A lot of tourists were actually inquiring about traveling to New York. However, it's the Philippine government who restricted travel out of the Philippines for non-essential purposes.
Pre-pandemic, hotel occupancy in New York City was at 98 to 100% during the holidays. But Yvonne Melendez of Hilton's of New York City said a 30% occupancy rate is the highest they can get nowadays from mostly local travelers.
With all the restrictions that are actually put in place right now for New York, where you're coming in, then you also need to quarantine for 3 days, and then the fourth day get tested. A lot of our groups that are coming in are only coming in for 3 or 4 days. So it impacts them as well, because they feel, what's the point of coming in? I'm going to spend most of my time quarantined.
New York officials predict that it could take up to 4 years for the Big Apple's tourism industry to recover from the damage caused by the pandemic. Don Tagala, ABS-CBN News, New York.
The wedding industry definitely took a hit due to the pandemic, and Hawaii, a tourist destination for many couples, saying I do, is reeling from economic impacts. Lenny now talks to business establishments affected as well as lovebirds left with no choice but to postpone their dream island wedding.
2020 was supposed to be the year of I do's for many couples around the world. That is, of course, until the pandemic hit. Because big physical gatherings have been banned, ceremonies either turned digital, were downsized drastically, postponed, or canceled altogether.
According to a report by the Hawaii Visitor and Convention Bureau, the wedding industry alone roughly brings in about $16 billion in revenue annually to the state.
But in 2020, many wedding destinations like Hawaii took an economic hit.
We're having all these weddings be at like 5 capacity. Like, no one's going to want to come and have their wedding here. No one is going to want to just have 5 people at their wedding.
I usually do 180-ish events a year. And we're looking at for the year, because we had the January, February locked in, we're probably not even going to make 20 this year.
A new analysis from financial company Lonery found that 1 in 9 couples, or 225,000 engaged pairs, who were planning to marry in 2020 now owe $3.7 billion in personal loans for canceled weddings during the pandemic. This comes up to an average of over $16,000 per couple. This Phil Am engaged couple originally planned to get married in May, but they've had to reschedule twice because of the pandemic. They decided to schedule a big ceremony for November 2021 if the pandemic is indeed over.
We spent a lot of money on already, and if we were to cancel it, we would lose all of that. So that's why we're just going to go through it what we originally planned, and also because I still want my big wedding.
Non-Hawaii residents who want that small dream island wedding may welcome the state's decision to ease up on travel restrictions. Last month, Hawaii, in an effort to boost the economy, began allowing travelers to forego a mandatory 14-day quarantine if they are able to provide a negative COVID-19 test prior to arrival. Lulaine Ignau, ABS-CBN News, Honolulu, Hawaii.
And that's it for BA this Monday, November 23rd. You may also catch our stories on our website, balitangamerica.tv, as well as on our Twitter and Facebook pages. I'm TJ Manotok. Till tomorrow, stay safe, Kapamilya.